I'm happy to introduce Neil Ormerod from Australia. I've met Neil in many places throughout the world. I remember early in the morning in Mainz, Germany, pulling my bag through a cobblestone street in the middle of the night, and there was Neil also pulling his bag through the cobblestone street to head elsewhere. So when you're from Australia, you travel a lot, I think. And Neil, I've asked Neil before to come to Seton Hall, and fortunately had a Catholic Theological Society meeting in San Diego in California, and also a meeting at Fairfield University. So he was able to come by for a few days, so I said, let's have Neil give a talk here. Neil has a very interesting background. He first had a PhD in mathematics, and then he got into theology and has become a well-known theologian throughout the world. He's a professor of theology at Australian Catholic University. He's published in the Theological Studies, Irish Theological Quarterly, and the Australian Catholic Record. His most recent books include Creation, Grace, and Redemption, and with Cynthia Crisdale, Creator God, Evolving World, Fortress Press, and there's also a new book.
Yeah. Revisioning the Church.
Revisioning the Church. So I asked Neil to lead us in a conversation. So he said he'd be glad to, but I asked him especially to touch on the Trinity and the psychological analogy of the Trinity, which is very prominent in St. Augustine and Thomas Aquinas. So anyway, I'm very happy to introduce Neil for a conversation with us, especially about the Trinity, because I'm learning what I should have learned many years ago. So, thanks.
It's lovely to be here, and I'm so grateful to Dick making this possible. I think you all know Dick's one of the great gentlemen of the church, and we hit it off well from the early times. Let me start with just a couple of stories, and then we'll sort of spell out what we'll be looking at today. One is, it's something, this is a little booklet for those who aren't into the technicalities and want something really basic on the Trinity. This is a little book that I wrote a couple of years ago. It's available through Liturgical Press, so it's available in the US. But I start that book with a little anecdote. And I was at an iftar dinner. Do you know what an iftar dinner is? It's when Muslims are in Ramadan. At the end of the evening, they have a meal. They fast during the day, and at the end of the day, when the sun sets, they have a meal. And in Australia, we're having this tradition of Muslims inviting non-Muslims to join Muslim families to have this meal at the end of the day at Ramadan. And sometimes they have very formal meals. So I was at one of these very formal meals. It was in our state parliament house. And so, you know, it was a room much bigger than this. And I was sitting next to a young Muslim man. And we started conversation, and he said to me, my mother was a Catholic and my father was a Muslim. So it's a pretty unusual situation. So that when I grew up, I had to make a decision about where I wanted to be. And he said, the one thing I couldn't get my head around was the Trinity. So I started talking to Catholics about it. And I'd ask them questions. And not one of them could say anything intelligent to me. I even went and spoke to a bishop, he said, and I still couldn't get anything intelligent out of him. So I thought, if these people don't know what it is, I may as well be a Muslim. So I'm not going to ask you, but what sort of response would you be able to give if a Muslim came to you or someone who was searching and asked you about the Trinity? And how would you be able to respond to that? A second thing that just occurred the other day, like many of us, I'm on Facebook and I have various friends, and one's at St. Michael, it's Regis College in Toronto. And it's one of these online surveys that people did, and people were asked, I think, 10 basic questions about the Trinity. And the results of this survey were astoundingly ignorant in terms of what people could say simply about what it is they believe in the Trinity. One of the questions, because I'm a layman, I've got a wife and four children and six grandchildren, but I have taught priests over the years, and I've usually, one of the courses I often teach them, of course, is the course on the Trinity. And I'll start off by asking them, who of you has ever heard a decent homily on Trinity Sunday? Because my experience is usually a priest getting up and saying, the Trinity is a terrible mystery or a big mystery, let's talk about something else. Because they don't understand. And of course, I usually end my class by saying to them, by the end of the semester, and of course, one day you will be preaching on Trinity Sunday, and I might be in the congregation. So make sure it's good. Okay? Now, what I want to do today is just go through a few different steps, and look, feel free to ask any question you like about this at any time. You know, any question you want to ask but have been afraid to ask before about the Trinity, feel free to ask at some stage. But I want to start off looking at some scriptural material, just briefly, and some creedal material, just briefly. And then say, well, if this is what we believe, how do we understand it? What does it mean to understand this mystery? And that will bring in the elements that Dick mentioned before about the psychological analogy. But I think before we start talking about that, we just have to lay some common ground work so we're all sort of on the same page. Okay? So, there's a handout, and a good a place as any. In fact, the best place to start, of course, is with the scriptures. And so I've got a sheet there with a series of quotes from the scripture. It's not the whole thing that we can say about the Trinity, of course, in the scriptures, but it's a start. But of course, before that, we've got to place this in the context of the Old Testament. One of the things that's new about the New Testament is this radically transformed understanding of what it means for God to be God. The Old Testament, of course, is very strong on the unity of God. Remember, Israel, the Lord your God is one. There is no other. And the followers of Jesus in that initial period, of course, were all strongly bound by that sense of Jewish monotheism, that God is one. But at the same time, something happens, something new, something unexpected happens in the New Testament, which radically revises the Christian understanding of what it means to be God. And of course, that that really significant, I suppose the two significant things that happened, but the first really significant thing that happens is Jesus. Here is this human being who enters into their lives, after which everything is different. And that's probably why we're here too, because everything is different because of Jesus. And when we look at the New Testament literature, one way to sort of look at it is the whole structure of it is a hymn of praise to Jesus. Nothing can be, everything has to be said about him. Like everything that can possibly be said about how good, how great, how important, how significant. So he's the son of David, he's the son of God, he's a new Moses, he's the new Elijah, he's all these titles and superlatives which they lay at the feet of Jesus. Why? Because they love him. They love him so radically, so significantly, that if he were not God, it would be idolatrous. The language that they use in relationship to Jesus is so overwhelming and so unrestrained in its adoration. And you can see this is, of course, why Jews and Muslims, of course, object to Christianity, because in that sense, we do treat Jesus as God. But if we do treat Jesus as God and he's not God, then we are committing idolatry. But if we treat Jesus as God and he is God, then this actually causes us to rethink our understanding of who God is. And that's the situation in which the New Testament authors find themselves. Committed both to the monotheism of Judaism and to this new unexpected thing that has happened, this new unexpected thing in Jesus. And it's an awkward place to be. When you actually look at the New Testament data and the number of times in which the New Testament will say something like Jesus is God or something explicit like that, there are actually only a handful of texts, such as St. Thomas at the post-resurrection scene where he says, "My Lord and my God." These sort of texts are relatively rare in the New Testament. So there's a sort of tentativeness about being that explicit about this new thing. On the other hand, there is this exuberance which is present, this deep love, this overwhelming love that they have for Jesus. Now, you know, we could talk forever about how that came about, but I'm presuming that we share that, so we have some idea about how that comes about for us anyway. The other aspect, of course, is that I suppose is last weekend, Pentecost Sunday. It's Trinity Sunday on Sunday. How good a timing is that? You know? Dick hadn't put the two together, but it's Trinity Sunday coming up, so this is good. Is this outpouring of the Spirit, this radically transformative experience in their own lives, empowering, encouraging, transforming them, empowering them in particular for ministry and mission, engagement with the world. This was another new thing. There's a new thing that's happening here. God's Spirit is being poured out in a new way, in a new and unexpected way. So we get these triadic formulae, and a lot of them we're actually quite familiar with, because they're woven into the language of our liturgy. And so a lot of this is picked up. One of the things when I do teach this with students, of course, is just to sensitize them to the language of the liturgy and how Trinitarian the language of the liturgy is. The Gloria, the Creed, the Eucharistic Prayer, the doxology of the Eucharistic Prayer. There are constant references to the Trinity throughout our Eucharistic celebration. So these particular ones. The first one I'll leave a while because it's the most obvious one, but it's also the one which is most different from all the others. I'll explain why that's significant. But just to go through these, but we were all. Ought always to thank God for you, brothers, loved by the Lord, because from the beginning God chose you to be saved through the sanctifying work of the Spirit and through belief in the truth. He called you to this through our gospel, that you might share in the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. So this triadic formula of Father, God, Son, and Spirit. Becomes a recurrent theme. There are different gifts, but the same Spirit. Different kinds of service, but the same Lord, meaning Jesus. There are different kinds of working, but the same God works all of them. The one we use as a blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. So here we get that designation, that name for God as Father. And of course one of the things I think Catholics sort of fall into, certainly most of my students, so I perhaps shouldn't generalise beyond that, but even to start talking about God as Father is new. There's something new about the way in which Jesus addresses God as Father, very personal, not unique, I believe. But there's a sense in which when we hear that, we often think, oh, God the Father is the God of the Old Testament. That's probably what most people think most of the time. And it's not actually quite right. It's not actually quite right. The God of the Old Testament is actually God who is Father, Son, and Spirit. And as Jesus says in the Gospel, nobody knows the Father except the Son. No one knows the Son except the Father and those to whom he chooses to reveal it. There's a mutual relationship there which defines both Father and Son. We only know God as Father in knowing him as the Father of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. So there's a mutual relationship. The Old Testament knew the fatherhood of God, but then so did the Stoic philosophers would speak of the fatherhood of God. But they didn't know God as Father, the way in which Christians understand God as Father. Because we can only know God as Father in the revelation of Jesus. Because the Father is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So when Jesus talks about him, he talks about my Father and your Father. He is your Father in as much as he is my Father. and we are brought in to be sons and daughters with Jesus through our relationship with him to God the Father. So there's a just a little bit, when we look at the creed, I'll come back to this and we can see how this plays a little bit out in the creed. But that sort of default position that somehow the Old Testament is about God the Father, strictly speaking, isn't correct. Though it's often the way we speak. In fact, you can actually get some of the early church fathers who see the God of the Old Testament as the Son, because it was a manifestation of God in salvation history. That's another issue. But just to remind ourselves that even this revelation of God as Father is new. It is a new thing. It's much more than the fatherhood of God. It's about God's, but the Father's relationship to Jesus and Jesus' relationship to the Father. Let me, got to keep track of time here. See, I love this stuff and I can go on about it. Look, and we'll let you, I'll let you read those, but I'll go back to the one which is the most obvious one, which is the Matthew one. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, to which we all say amen. There are all sorts of discussions about this text. It looks like a late addition. It looks like a textual variant that has become the norm. Why? Because we know in the early Christian communities, the earliest baptismal formulae that we have, that people were baptized in the name of Jesus. And the idea of them being baptized in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit looks like a development on that. But still, it is part of our canonical scriptures, so it is important. What's significant about it, in fact, is that whereas each of the other references that we have to Father, Son and Spirit there treats them just a little bit differently. So the love of God, grace of Jesus Christ, you know, there'll be variations on the role or significance of the persons, the distinct Father, Son and Spirit, or God, Son and Spirit. But in this formula, they're just given in the same role, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. There is no differentiation, just a sequence. There is no difference of role. This becomes important later on in the sort of creedal developments, that we understand that there is a radical equality here between Father, Son and Spirit. In the early church debates, as we'll see when we look at the creed, there's a constant pressure to see the Son and the Spirit as, okay, they're over there with God, but they're somehow at a second rank, or, you know, second-rate gods, third-rate gods. So you have this hierarchy of gods, or a hierarchy of divinity. This particular formula of Father, Son, and Spirit, baptized in the name of Father, Son, and Spirit, treats them all at the same level. That's part of what will lie behind, as you're all, you know, if you know, say the creed, the new word that we have to learn, consubstantial. Yeah, that they are consubstantial. Sorry, I've got the old version of the creed. It shows I haven't updated my translation there. But this word consubstantial, which means this radical equality of Father, Son and Spirit, we'll talk about that in a little while. Okay, now, just to summarise that, because we don't want to, we could talk more about the scripture, but just to summarise that, that what the scriptures present for us, and the technical word that is used is often the economic trinity. And what it means is the trinity involved in the economy of salvation. These are the Father, Son, and Spirit working out our salvation through the death and resurrection of Jesus, through the outpouring of the Spirit, through this marvellous and privileged experience that we have of God, which is brought to us in this threefold manner. That's the perspective. Another way of talking about it, God for us. This is God revealing God's self to us for our sake and for our salvation. But it raises questions, always questions, never ending questions, that people begin to ask. This is how God is revealing God's self to us. Is this how God truly is? Is this simply the way in which God is manifesting God's self to us? And God could have chosen some other way to do this? Or is this an actual revelation which pertains to God's own being? That becomes the question, the big question, that arises out of this Trinitarian language, which the church will then struggle with for the next 200 or 300 years to find some sort of resolution to. Okay. I'm just going to pause there and give you an opportunity, if you've got any questions on that what we've talked about, before we move on to looking at the creed. Yes.
So you have three persons and one God. So each of those three entities, what exactly, in your definition or in your studies, are they?
They're all God. We're not there yet. I mean, in terms of what the scriptures present to us, the language of person is not there.
Is that a true interpretation of the original intent of the biblical scripture writers as persons, or were they thinking of some other? That's kind of the direction I meant to ask.
They weren't asking that question.
They were.
Yeah, they weren't. Those questions arise naturally. But they aren't their questions. The scriptural questions are, whoa, this is happening to us. We are being transformed by this. They're not speculative documents. They are pastoral documents. They are gospel. They are good news. They are about engaging us and transforming us. So the questions that we ask, we will not find answered by the scriptures, because that's not their interest. On the other hand, these questions do arise and we have to address them. So what does it mean to say, baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit? How can this be? What is it that differentiates them? These are all questions which the biblical authors have no interest in, because they're trying to convert you. But once you're converted, once you're in this life and you're an intelligent human being, you will ask those questions. So that's why, and this process still goes on. So we still ask those questions. Yeah.
Recently I read that, is there the idea of person?
Yeah.
There's something inherently ambiguous the way it comes to us from the Latin in person.
Augustine has a great line in De Trinitate, and he says, what are there three of in the Trinity? And he says, well, they're three persons, he says, not because we know what it means, but because we have no other word by which we can speak of them. So the word person there is a heuristic. It's a tag, it's a label to name what we don't fully understand, but need to further understand. Significantly, in the definition, the creedal definitions of the Trinity, of course, the word person is not used. It's used in the Christological definitions of Chalcedon. So you don't actually find it in Nicaea or Constantinople, but it becomes a technical phrase to use for that which is distinct of the Trinity. And then they leave it for mugs like me to explain how this use of the word person bears any relationship to what it means in other situations. One more question, then we have to move on. Sorry, yes?
Well, I had just attended, it's more of a comment, the faculty seminar on basically Lonergan's general empirical method. And when we try to understand something of this magnitude, so to speak, what I liked about Lonergan, and again, this is just my perception, is that if we see it as like three concentric circles as one, then we also have to understand where faith and reason, there's belief.
Yeah.
So as much as we use language, perhaps, to try to describe this phenomena of the Trinity, then we must really transcend to a belief system of faith.
Yeah.
I mean, but that's just, my perception, because I find the Trinity also, when you introduced your conversation, that it's pretty overwhelming to even try to conceive of it as much as language.
Absolutely.
So that's how I'm trying. I'm really becoming more a belief in Lonergan and how he understands, and I'm only a beginner.
Yeah.
The concept of God and the Trinity is really through belief.
It is. It's a belief which emerges out of that transformative experience that the early Christians had. And we have been left for the last 2,000 years to struggle to articulate the significance of that. And it's more than we can possibly understand. But we can perhaps get some glimmer of it. And that's one of, as Dick mentioned, the psychological analogy. One of the beauties of this analogy is that I think it gives perhaps the best way of entering into that mystery. And there are still further developments to be made, and I might sort of get on to some of those briefly. It's a way in which we can say, if this young Muslim had spoken to me, I would have taken him through this, and then I would have talked about this psychological analogy as a way of trying to say, this is one way to try and understand it. And it can be made very, very complicated and technical, or it can be made in a simple sort of common sense sort of way. And hopefully I'll be able to do some of that. Okay. Can we move on now to the creed, if you're Catholic, you're familiar with it, and other churches recognise this creed. The Creed of Nicaea, of course, is the common creed. It's not just the Catholic creed. It's a creed to which Christians as a whole, it's almost an identifying symbol of Christian faith. And it arose out of controversy. And the controversy, as I said, is precisely this question. This is how God has revealed God's self to us. Is this how God truly is? Is this how God truly is? Is God perhaps wearing three different masks, so that he appears as Father and he appears as Son, or he appears as Spirit. But that's not how God truly is. He's just this way because that's how it is for us best to understand it. Are the Son and the Spirit somehow lesser God? Not at the same level as the Father. These are different opinions which arose in those first couple of centuries after the New Testament era. The way in which the church responds to this is, well, first to convene a council. And of course, the person who convened the council was the emperor. So the first real general ecumenical council was convened by a layperson, which is great. I don't see anything wrong with that. It may not have even been Christian at the time, but that's another issue. But he convened it. Why did he convene it? Because this was becoming a disruptive debate within the empire itself. Christians were fighting in the street over this. Can you imagine Christians today fighting in the street over the doctrine of the Trinity? I don't think so. But they were so passionate about these issues. They were so passionate that they were going around beating one another up to, no, you're wrong, you know, got to believe this way, this way. So calling a council was an issue of state peace. And as far as I could see, the emperor had no interest in what solution they came up with. He just wanted a solution. So a number of bishops gathered. The Pope did not come at the time. It's a long way. Couldn't just pop on a jet and fly there. So several days' journey. But he sent delegates. And Council of Bishops deliberated over this question. And the particular person that they had in mind was a priest named Arius, who had said, well, you can't actually have gradation of divinity. You're either God or you're not God. Tick. This was the Jewish insight. This is a very, very strong Jewish insight, that the gap between creator and creature, God is one, there is no other. So either you fall on the side of divinity, in which case you are fully divine, or you fall on the line of creature, in which case you are not divine. So in that regard, he was right. But he said, Jesus is on, or be a bit more, the Son is on the side of the creature. So he's not divine. This was what Arius taught. Now, this is what our creed is responding to. Now, before I get there, I should go back. When I talked about how the scriptures are God for us, there's one really important verse of scripture which begins to point in another direction. And there are probably others, but this is the most memorable one. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In the beginning. This is not to do with our salvation or anything. This is trying to say something about God in the beginning. The Word. The Word was with God. And the Word was God. This becomes a really important verse in terms of this debate. But it also points out, again, this is a shift that we have to make. It's a really important shift. That verse is not talking about Jesus who walked and talked in Galilee. It's talking about the Word. It's talking about prior to creation. in the beginning was the Word. It's talking about God's own being. So it's beginning to make that shift from God for us to something about God in God's self. It's just beginning to make that shift. Now, the debate that goes on leading up to Nicaea is not so much about Jesus who walked and talked in Galilee, but about the status of that Word or the Son. That's the issue. Another question will arise about the relationship between that Logos, between that Son, and the Jesus who walked and talked in Galilee. And that will be the subject of a further doctrinal statement in Chalcedon in 451. That takes another 120, 30 years to be resolved. But here the focus is really on the status of the Word. Now, what I've done there, if you look at that creed on that sheet, we believe in one God, Father Almighty. Just to unsettle things, I mean, we all get very comfortable in this, you know, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. Paul the Sixth, in the late 60s, issued the Credo of the People of God. So he issued a creedal statement for the church at that time. And it doesn't begin, we believe in one God, Father Almighty, Creator. It says, we believe in one God, Father, Son, and Spirit, Creator. So, just to remind ourselves that when we talk about the Father as Creator, it doesn't mean that the Son and Spirit are not creators. They too are the one God who creates. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father. So this is in the beginning. Okay? Not to do, this is right prior to creation, eternally begotten of the Father. So this is part of God's own being. God from God, light from light, true God from true God. Each of these verses here was added to hammer a nail in the coffin of the position of Arius. God from God, light from light, true God from true God. Why true God from true God? Because Arius, the people who followed Arius, were saying, well, the Father is true God, but the Son is just God. They said, no, God from God, light from light, true God from true God. Begotten, not made. So not made, not a creature, but something else, which we use this word begotten. One in being or consubstantial. And what are this term, this apparent technical term that is introduced of substance, one substance with the Father. What on earth does one substance mean? And we can formulate all sorts of images about how this might make sense, but the only way of dealing with this constructively was devised by Athanasius, who was a deacon at the council and then later became a bishop, a very important figure in the early church. And he says, what does it mean to say the Father and the Son are consubstantial? Well, it means whatever we say that is true of the Father is true of the Son. If the Father is almighty, the Son is almighty. If the Father is eternal, the Son is eternal. If the Father is glorious, the Son is glorious. Whatever is true of one is true of the other. And that's all it means. It's a statement about statements. It's a second order statement. It's a statement which reinforces the full, complete and total divinity of the Son. But we want an image for it, and there ain't none. He's not going to give us an image. Okay? Athanasius is not going to give us an image. Instead, he's going to give us a rule. But the mind craves images, and inasmuch as we try and develop some image, we will be led astray. And that word substance, I know there's some would say substance, you divide it up and it's sub and stance. And some people will then say it's what stands under. So it's like there's some substratum reality thing. And I think, no, that's an image. It's an interesting image, but it doesn't actually help things. And why do we invert it? Because sub is under and stance is where you stand. So substance is about correct understanding. That's what substance means. If I correctly understand something, I have its substance. As when in a legal case, what is the substance of the argument? What's that core understanding around which the whole thing revolves? So if I correctly understand, I will speak truthfully, and what is true of the Father is true of the Son, except the Father is not the Son and the Son is not the Father. They are related. How are they related? The Father begets the Son and the Son is begotten by the Father. That is how they are related. That is how they are defined. So there become only two questions I can ask to give a meaningful answer. I can ask, what is the Son? The Son is God. Who is the Son? The Son is Son of the Father. That's what the language of person and nature means. Nothing more. Nothing less. It's the answer to those two questions. Who is the Father? The Father is God. Sorry, what is the Father? The Father is God. Who is the Father? He is the Father of the Son. Everything out of that is just speculative. Three persons, there are three whos, there is one what. One God, Father, Son, and Spirit. The Father is God. That's what the Father is. The Son is God. The Spirit is God. The Father is Father of the Son. The Son is Son of the Father. The Spirit is the Spirit of the Father and the Son. And the Father and Son bring out the Spirit. Okay? So, that's the first part of that. Now, I've indented the next part, which is the movement back to God for us. All those statements about the Son are all about God in God's own being. They're about what technically we call the immanent Trinity, God in God's self. But then it transitions to, and he came down from heaven, was conceived of the Holy, through the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, suffered, died, buried. All that's about the story of our salvation. That's the movement into God for us. But that God for us is grounded in a distinction within the Godhead itself, Father and Son. So that's that transition. That distinction between God for us and God in God's own being is written into the structure of the creed. So you get that that twofold element. Okay, let me keep a track of time here. Now, just to mention a little bit about the Spirit there, because a little bit about the Spirit there looks like a tack-on. No. Oh, let's not forget the Spirit. And it is. The whole debate at Nicaea was about the status of the Son, of the Logos. There was a subsequent debate about the status of the Spirit. And the creed that we say, which we call the Nicene Creed, was actually developed at the Council of Constantinople, 381. And further additions in terms of the spirit were tacked on. And basically the solution then was to say, well, we've already dealt with this in relationship to the psalm and the saint atones. So all the creed will say is, with equally glorified with the Father and the Son. So there's an equality of glory there, which places the Spirit in the realm of the divine in the same way in which the Son and the Father are in the realm of the divine. But they didn't feel the need to have a full statement the way that they did for the Son, because that was it wasn't a subject to as an intense debate. But it does give the impression, and perhaps rightly so, that the Spirit is a little bit neglected in our doctrinal statements, a little bit neglected in our theologizing. Of course, the other thing that arises is, if the Son and the Father are related as the Son is generated or begotten by the Father, how does the Spirit stand in relationship to the Father and the Son? And we know in our creed, we say, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. And in that little addition phrase, and the Son, there is a whole history of controversy that we could talk about for hours. And if we had anyone here from an Eastern Orthodox persuasion, we probably would end up talking for hours. And the initial creed, the creed at Constantinople, did not have that phrase in it. It was added later on in about the 8th century because of various disputes that are arising at the time. So the phrase was added into the creed. It reflects the theology of Augustine, and I'll just mention briefly why that's the case when we move on. But it is part of the Western doctrinal tradition. And I certainly am more than comfortable with it. I find the arguments for it quite persuasive. But again, let's have a pause for some questions on that and just make sure we're still on the same page here. Yeah.
If this takes you too far afield, please just answer yes or no.
Yeah.
But what I wanted to ask is that if Arius denied the divinity of Jesus, did he have an explanation that he offered for the fact that Jesus could save us by his death in the way that no other creature could?
He certainly did. And it was very much a sort of exemplary salvation. So Jesus was a sort of exemplar which we could then model ourselves on. Okay?
I think you referred to the principle of identity, the notion something cannot be what it is not. And how does that play into this understanding of one in three persons? Is it paradoxical?
That becomes one of the great things about creedal statements is that they never explain anything. They're teaching statements. They assert what is true. And they leave it for mugs like me to try and explain it to other people. And so those sort of technical questions arise then, say, in Augustine's De Trinitate. How do we distinguish these persons? There's a bit of a clue there in the creed where, with the language of procession and begotten, that there is a relational difference within the one God. So technically, the Father generates the Son, or the Son proceeds from the Father. The Father and the Son breathe the Spirit, and the Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. So these are relational terms. And those relational distinctions, Augustine will argue that is sufficient to establish the difference between the persons.
When did the Holy Ghost become Holy Spirit?
Oh, that's just a linguistic change. Just a change of almost translations. There's no deep significance in that, unfortunately. Just a change of terms. Yes.
So it's not a question, but more a comment. or maybe an expression of gratitude, because I never heard scriptures reframe as the moment of experience. You are giving me scripture back in a way that I was not anticipating. Because in many ways, what I'm hearing is that scripture, I mean New Testament scripture, New Testament scriptures are fundamentally the description of people touched by this encounter. They don't explain, they don't do anything but just giving testimony. This is what scripture is. And then you have the council as the place in which the church actually does the work of saying, okay, if this is the experience, what is it? What is really happening? I never had that distinction so clearly, and I think that is beautiful. It's just very nice.
Yeah. It's God's and some...
And also what is interesting is that there is a dynamism that is actually still occurring.
Yeah.
So it's clearly not done. It's clearly in the making, so it's interesting.
Yeah. It's God's... It's the New Testament story of salvation is God's work of art. It's this dramatic, transformative event in human history. We're part of the outcome of that. But like any great work of art which speaks truth, now I'm not saying that the New Testament doesn't speak truth, but it speaks it artistically, creatively. Well, we need to unpack it. So Newman's images of the big idea. Now we perhaps use an artistic metaphor, this dramatic event. For Newman, it was a big idea that will take centuries to unpack. And we continue to unpack it. On the other hand, I think there's something, when the church speaks the way it does at Nicaea, there's something quite definitive about that. We're not going to go back and say, oh, look, you know, we forgot there's another person of the Trinity we had to mention. No, we're not going to come up with four persons. It's always going to be three. And the structure that's set up there in the Creed, I think, is something that binds Christians as the Scriptures bind us, because they are a truthful account of what the Scriptures are conveying to us. One last question now. Yes.
You mentioned something very illuminating. You're talking about the relationship between father and son, and that's all there is to it in Christ's teaching as well. So the apostles were preachers, and they were brothers and sisters to Christ. Did the apostles feel that way when they were following Christ? Or that kind of awareness did not come to them until after the resurrection?
A good question, and I can't really say. I mean, so much of the story of Jesus is written through the lens of the resurrection that it's difficult to know what was happening before the resurrection and what is happening in the light of what they write in the light of what happened after the resurrection. So in that sense, we don't, you know, and there may be scripture experts who would, you know, want to pull out certain things. It's not my area. I'm not a scripture expert, but I think what's clear is that in their total experience of Jesus, that was the impact that it had on them at some point in there. Yeah. And for many of them at different points. Right, let's regroup. Where are you? We have this doctrine of Nicaea. We have a creed which says Father, Son and Spirit. It doesn't use the word person. Doesn't use any word, just says Father, Son, and Spirit. And it uses this word of one substance, consubstantial. How can this be? That becomes the question. How can it be? And the first question is, how can there be distinctions in God? And one answer to that, which becomes very, very significant, is one given by Augustine, which is that the persons are distinguished simply and solely by their relationships to one another. That the Father is the Father of the Son is the Son of the Father. Within the one Godhead, this distinction of relationship is the only distinction which exists. That actually then leads him to that addition clause that the Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. Quite simply, he argues, well, if we say that the Father is the Father of the Son, and the Son is the Son of the Father, we say that the Spirit is the Spirit of the Father, but we don't say that the Father is the Father of the Spirit, because that would make the Spirit another Son. So something else has to be going on. Something else has to be going on. And the only thing that he can come up with is to say that the Son must be implicated in the relationship of the Father and the Son to the Spirit. So the Spirit is the Spirit of the Father and the Son. This is an argument from the logic of relationships. But it's also one for which he gives a scriptural argument. He also looks at the scripture and he finds evidence that the Spirit is called the Spirit of Jesus, it's called the Spirit of God, so it is the Spirit of the Father and the Son. So he's got scriptural reasons. He's got an argument from relationships, which is good. And he'll develop another argument that we'll see later on. But that's a technical sort of argument that he gives to say that the relationship between the Son, between the Spirit and the Father, cannot be the same as the relationship between the Son and the Father, or we would end up with two sons. And certainly, the Greek fathers who predated Augustine were well aware of this problem. And they would ask the question, why is the Spirit not a second Son? But the solution that they gave, to my mind at least, was a purely linguistic solution. It gives no real insight into the difference. It just says, well, the Son proceeds by generation and the Spirit proceeds by spiration. And then you ask, what does that mean? And they say, well, the Son proceeds by generation and the Spirit proceeds by spiration. It's a linguistic differentiation, but there's no clear, to my mind anyway, no clear insight into it. Yes?
Is the Spirit actually created because of the relationship?
The Spirit is not created. See the language?
That's language.
That's the Spirit is not created because the Spirit is God. The Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. The Son is generated, begotten, as they say, we say in the Creed, begotten, not made. They are eternally constitutive of God's being. So we don't say that the Son is created or the Spirit is created. They are generated, they proceed, whatever language we choose.
I mentioned to Dick during the break that I had read a passage of St. Maximilian Kolbe in which he basically says that the Spirit is the original Immaculate Conception, and that the love between the Father and the Son generates the third person.
Yeah, yeah, and what we need to do is to see what that might mean. Mm-hmm. Now, let's go back to John 1. In the beginning was the Word. and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This is a really interesting way of describing this second person of the Trinity. What does it mean for God to have a word? And what does it mean for God to have a word? This is, I'm sure this played on Augustine's mind, and certainly he was not the only one. Some of the Greek fathers thought about this too. God speaks, but there is an obvious word, the word that I'm speaking here. You can hear me, hopefully. But it's a spoken word in the way that I produce it linguistically. Air is moving in and out, all that sort of stuff. Well, that can't be what we mean by God having a word, because God doesn't have lungs, God doesn't have a tongue. But something else might be happening. So Augustine begins to ask the question, what is happening inside me when I generate that spoken word? Is there something prior going on internally within me that I can say is a word being generated that might in some way provide an analogy for the way in which God generates a word? This is the question that drives what will be called the psychological analogy. But before we can go there, we have to know not about God, but about ourselves. Because it isn't a question about God, it's a question about us. And while all of us know that we know, oh yeah, I know about this, I know about that, we rarely ask the question, how do I know? What am I doing when I know? And in fact, when people start asking that question, we tend to get annoyed because we have to stop and think, and we have to sort of attend to certain things within ourselves. And there's this great part in Augustine's De Trinitate, book 8 of De Trinitate, where he almost takes people through what I would call a series of five-finger exercises. If it was music, it'd be, you know, getting fingers limbered up. And he says, think about how you come to know something. Think about what it's like to form a definition. Think about what it's like to make a judgment. What are you doing when you're doing that? And how familiar are you with your own operations? Because if you're not familiar with those, I'm not going to be able to take you into book 9. So start getting familiar with yourself. And once he's taken the reader through those five-finger exercises, then he leads on to this psychological analogy, or at least the first part of it that's most significant. Now, I haven't got a set of five-finger exercises, but I have a one-finger exercise for you. And it's, I'm a mathematician. Sorry. It's Pythagoras' theorem. It's interesting just to if you skip ahead to Thomas Aquinas. The first question when Thomas Aquinas is dealing with the issue of the Trinity, the first question that Thomas Aquinas asks, are there processions in God? That's the very first question. And of course, you've got a dogmatic answer to that. Yes, the creed, scripture, blah, blah, blah. But then he says, well, how do we understand this? And he says, it's like the way in which we generate a concept from our understanding. That's what it's like. That the Son is the conceptual expression, the word that God generates out of the divine self-understanding. So if we want to grasp something of what that's like, we actually have to have an active understanding and know what it's like to generate a word out of that active understanding. Because if we don't do that, we don't know what he's talking about. Now mathematics, because when I was a mathematician, which seems like a lifetime ago, and particularly when I was a student, like having acts of understanding was habitual, in the sense that every lecture you went to, you'd have insight after insight after insight after insight. So I think this is one of the reasons why I felt very familiar with particularly Bernard Lonergan talking about appropriating your own act of understanding, because that was my life as a mathematics undergraduate. Just insights all the time, every lecture. And you had to work through them, and you became very familiar with what was going on. This particular one goes back right to high school. Everyone knows Pythagoras' theorem. Everyone. Square on the hypotenuse is equal to the sum of the squares on the other two sides. Everyone learns it by rote. How do you prove it? What's the insight there that generates that word? The word is the formula. What is the act of understanding that moves us from one to the other? When I was a mathematics teacher, which I did at university for a few years, it was always important for me to see, to get the student to understand. Because if they understood, they were in control. If they didn't understand, it was just a formula, and they would stuff it up. If they understood, they could generate the formula themselves as they needed it. So the whole point is to understand. Now, if you look at that first diagram there, you've got a right angle triangle, and you've got a square on the hypotenuse and a square on the other two sides. And I reckon you could stare at that from now till kingdom comes and never have any insight into what on earth is going on. Now, a clever mathematician, clever enough mathematician, can work out how to use that diagram in order to produce Pythagoras' theorem. It's messy. You can go on the internet and you can see proofs of Pythagoras' theorem using that diagram. Look at the second diagram. Here the square on the hypotenuse, instead of being written, drawn at the bottom, is flipped over to the top. It's the same square on the hypotenuse, only it's flipped over to the top. And you've got four copies of the one triangle. And there's a square in the middle. And as long as that is a right angle triangle that you have drawn, that's why I'm always reluctant to do this on a whiteboard, because you never get it quite right.
as long as you got a right angle triangle, you have a square in the middle. And you can imaginatively twist and deform it. It's a bit like a photographic lens made of a little aperture that opens up on your camera. It's always got the same shape in the middle. That's the insight, that no matter how you vary this, you get the same basic picture. There's an intelligibility to be grasped there. That's the insight. That's all you need. Well, it's not quite all you need, because it doesn't give you a formula. What it says is there is an interrelationship between square and the hypotenuse, the square in the middle, and the four triangles. To get to the formula, you need to work. That's the generation of the word. You need to label the diagram. You need to do a little bit of elementary algebra. And you work through it, and you come up with a formula. But you are able to do it because you understand. You had that act of understanding. And that act of understanding generates the formula. That's what it means to say that a concept is generated by an act of understanding. It's because I understand. My understanding, in a sense, causes it, but it's a very particular type of causing. It's a be-causing. Because I understand, I can do this. And it's something every teacher of mathematics knows in their students. Those who understand, and because they understand, can generate the formula. And those who don't understand and are reliant simply on memorizing the formula. Okay? So that's an example of generating a word. It's an interior process that we go through. That's what Augustine and Aquinas want us to think about in this process of understanding psychological analogy. That's not the only type of word that we generate, and I want to talk about two other types of word that we generate as well, because sometimes they're a little bit easier for people to grasp what it is that's going on. And Augustine uses this one as well. When I make a judgment, so Flanagan would say, insights, dime a dozen. You've got to check them out. You've got to verify them in the data. You have to go back and ask further questions. You have to weigh things up. But in that process, the mind converges to a point where I speak a word. What's the word I speak? Gotcha. Yes. Or, no, wrong. Start again. But I've had a good insight. The evidence accumulates. There comes a point where I commit myself to the judgment and say yes. That's an inner word. It's not the yes I speak. It's something that happens interiorly to me. That's generating a word. The other, of course, is not the judgment of fact, but the judgment of value. Yes. And this is good. This is truly good. Each of these requires of me a sort of increasing gradation of personal commitment. To generate Pythagoras is theorem. I'm intellectually involved, but that's about it. To generate the word of judgment of truth, of fact, requires some personal commitment, because I could be wrong, but I'm committing myself to this. Commit myself to a judgment of value engages me existentially, because my judgments of value are expressions of who I am. Okay? So when we think of the word is like a concept generated or a judgment generated. This is where I said to my students, you know, in the beginning was the word. What was the word? What was the word? The word was yes. It's a judgment of truth and value of all that God is and all that God does. The Father speaks this inner word of yes. Okay? And you can go back to St. Paul, I think it's the second letter to the Corinthians, where Paul says, of all the promises made to us by the Father, Jesus is yes to them all. There is no yes or no in Jesus. He is the yes. He is the yes of God. So Jesus is the incarnation of God's yes to the whole creation, to everything that God is and to everything that God does. That's what it means to say that the Son is the Word generated by the Father. And because this Word completely expresses, fully expresses everything that the Father is, He is identical to the Father. Everything that the Father is, He perfectly expresses. So that the Father and He are one substance. Everything that is true of the Father is true of the Son. Except the Father speaks the Son, or speaks the Word, and the Word is spoken by the Father. That reciprocity of relationship. Father to Son, Son to Spirit. Or for those who find the language of Father and Son not inclusive, the speaker and the Word. The Father is the eternal speaker of the Word. Aquinas actually refers to the Father as the speaker. He says, the speaker speaks the Word. It's the correlate of words. Okay. You get that? Now, we still haven't spoken of the Holy Spirit. You know, we still haven't spoken of the Holy Spirit. Let me it's tiring work, you know. Particularly when you've had this is 10 hours out of my time zone, so it's probably about 3 o'clock in the morning or something. Sometimes you just get. What about the Holy Spirit? Well, both Augustine and Aquinas will speak of the Word as a word spoken in love. It's a loving word. And we think of that now as a judgment of value. So it's a judgment of value about something. When I make a judgment of value about something, say, yes, this is good. So, what do I do? There's still something required of me that comes from making that commitment. there's a love which emerges for that which is good, that I have judged as good. If I judge something as good and do not generate a love for that, then there's something deficient in me. It would be wrong. It would be wrong to do that. But if I do make a judgment of value, then there is something which flows out of that judgment, which is the proper and proportionate love of the value that I have attained. So that the Spirit proceeds out of that judgment from the Father and the Son, the Father's judgment expressed in the Word, as a state of, or it's an expression of love. And it's a particular type of love. Fred Crow had a great, Fred was a great Lonergan scholar, and he had the article, or a couple of articles, Complacency and Concern in Thomas Aquinas. And sometimes when I make a judgment of value, it's not, there's something I have to do. Like, I have to make a decision and I have to change something. That's concern. That's concerned love. But there's another type of love that Thomas Aquinas calls complacent love. And the word complacent doesn't sound right in English, but it's that resting in love. It's that, wow, I could just be here forever. I could just love this forever. It's not requiring me to do anything, but simply to enjoy. So this judgment of value, the Spirit then is God's enjoyment of God's self. It is that divine delight in God being God, which is the expression that emerges out of this judgment of value that the Son is. Now, let me see. The tiredness is starting to click in, and I have to think, now, where do I want to take this? Look, let me just pause and just see if you've got any questions, because there is a direction I want to take this. Now, I mean, one thing that's important about this is none of this is church teaching, let me say, except I mean, all the doctrine of the Trinity stuff is. This is simply a theological attempt to understand how it is that God can speak a word and how it is that that word can generate a spirit. It's an analogy. If you've got a better one, let me know.